man honoreth his father, and a servant his master. If then I be a father, where is mine honor? And if I be a master, where is my fear, says the Lord of hosts unto you, O priests that despise my name? And ye say, wherein have we despised thy name? You offer polluted bread upon mine altar, and ye say, wherein have we polluted thee? In that ye say, the table of the Lord is contemptible. Malachi 1, verses 6 and 7. Hi, this is Minister Pat Holmes at Saints on Assignment Ministries, coming to you live once again from the secret place, speaking the blessings of the Lord upon you, your household, everything that pertains to you. No matter what you're going through, remember Jesus is Lord. He's a God that gives breakthrough and a God that gives victory. I want to encourage you to trust in Him. Glory to God. Well, I want to share something the Holy Ghost just downloaded in me less than 24 hours ago. First, he was reminding me of natural vehicles here on this earth, our automobiles. And these modern vehicles, as you know, they send messages when something is wrong. If you're driving and you go over the line, that vehicle will let you know you're over the line. If the air is too low in the tires, it'll let you know concerning the air. If you need to check your battery, it will let you know that. Well, so it is concerning us, the ministers of the gospel. Glory to God. The Holy Ghost will download and use us as His mouthpiece to bring alignment in the body of Christ. And this is an alignment message. I am going to simply put up on the screen exactly what He gave me. As He was downloading it, I was typing it. This message will deal with what He first told Abraham, walk thou perfect before me, which means walk with maturity. Oh, glory to God. Walk with maturity. Walk with the spirit of excellence before me. We will deal with strange fire in the church. We will deal with God being a meticulous builder. When He began to speak, as you remember, to Moses, as well as to Noah concerning the building of the ark, Moses concerning the building of the tabernacle, God had specifications on His divine blueprint. We are the body of Christ. There are some specifications that we need to look at. Let me just bring up page 1. And at the very top, just a little note that the Lord gave me concerning the two attitudes that He has noticed in the body of Christ. There are those that say they love God, and they do, but they'll make this statement, which shows that they are with a compromising spirit. They're trying to walk as close to the world and yet serve God at the same time. And their mindset, their attitude will say, there is nothing wrong with it. When you try to bring alignment, there's nothing wrong with it. Oh, but there are those in the body of Christ with this mindset that says, with Him, I want nothing wrong. I want you to meditate on that for a moment. There's nothing wrong with it. Oh, I was in that group at one time. I remember we'd open our home up and ministers would come in and minister. And sometimes they would present challenging texts from the Bible that challenged the flesh on the inside of me, challenged my carnality. And I was of that mindset. There's nothing wrong with that. Oh, but as you grow closer to the Master, glory to God, you will move to a place where you're saying, with Him, I want nothing wrong. On the screen, you see Genesis 17 and verse 1, when God spoke to Abram, and it says, and when Abram was 90 years and 9, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Oh, glory to God. Walk before me and be thou perfect. In other words, walk with maturity. Walk with the spirit of excellence. And in 1 Kings 8 and verse 61, we see this. Let your heart, therefore, there's that word, be perfect with the Lord our God. To walk in His statutes. The word statutes means decreed limits. We can't do everything we want to do and live a carnal lifestyle, live a fleshly lifestyle. The Lord has statutes, decreed limits. You can't continue to fornicate and live in adultery and yet go and minister on the altar, oh my God, saying that you're off and up, praise and worship unto the Lord. God said he's a great king, and I'll read that scripture in a moment, and he does not receive everything. That is exactly why he told Cain to go and get it right, and then come back and present your offering. He does not receive everything. So again, with this scripture in 1 Kings 8:61, he said, walk in his statutes, again, his decreed limits, to keep his commandments at this day. So God wants us to keep his commandments, walk with a perfect heart. In other words, maturity and a spirit of excellence according to his divine blueprint, the word of God. We move down on the outline and we see Psalms 101 and verse 2. And it says, I will behave myself wisely in a what? Perfect way. There's that word again, in a perfect way. He says, when wilt thou come unto me? And he says, I will walk through my house. Look at that. I want to say it again. I will walk within my house with a what? Perfect heart. Glory to God. Then we go over to to Ephesians in the New Testament. And let me see if I have it up there where you can see it. Let me scroll it up. I think it is still on there, but let me pull this up a bit. And you see it on screen. We're reading now Ephesians, and I lost my place. Ephesians 5:15. And it says, see then that ye walk circumspectly. Do you know what circumspectly means? It means to walk pointedly and accurately. It's a term that we think of when we think of law enforcement, and when they pull over suspected drunk drivers, they will have them walk that straight line, and they have to walk pointedly and accurately. Well, that is the term that is used here in Ephesians 5:15. See then that you walk circumspectly, pointed and accurately, not as fools. Oh my goodness, I want to say that again. Not as fools. There are those that have fallen prey to the foolishness of the world and yet decreeing, oh, when he comes, I'm going to be with him. But the Bible says the Lord knows those that are his. So it warns us here not to walk as fools, that we are to walk circumspectly. But it tells us, but as wise. We have to be children of the light that walk in the wisdom of God, not doing it our way, living it our way, and yet saying that he is accepting us in that situation or status that we're in. God has given us the Holy Spirit, and he is sent to perfect us and to mature us and to cause us to be transformed into the image of God, that we can be pleasing in his sight. Not everything is pleasing in God's sight. You're going to see that within these scriptures. The next statement that the Lord gave me, let me see if it's on the screen. I believe it is. And let me read it from here. And it says, reference Nadab and Abihu. Now, most of you will remember Nadab and Abihu. They were Moses' nephews, and they were Aaron's son. Aaron was the first high priest in the tabernacle. These were Aaron's son. So this passage will let you see, it doesn't matter who you're related to. Each one of us have to line up and walk in maturity and with the spirit of excellence before God. They were dedicating the tabernacle. The tabernacle had been built, and these two boys who were serving in the office of priests under Aaron, who was the high priest, their daddy, they were to put fire in their censers and come in and light the altar of incense. Now look at this, Leviticus 10:1. Look at what happened. And Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, took either of them his censer and put fire therein, and put incense thereon, and offered, look at that, you see what it says? And offered strange fire before the Lord, which he commanded them not. As I brought out earlier, God is a God of meticulous order. He had already given instructions as to how it was to be done. But these young priests brought common fire into the house. Oh my God. And I get to see so much of that, where we reach out in the world, we get the world's tunes, we get the world's style of dressing, and we come and stand on the altar before a meticulous divine God, and we say, "Here, God." But I want you to see what happened, because there are some things we need to be reminded of. Leviticus 10 and verse 2, "And there went out fire from the Lord and devoured them, and they died before the Lord." Fire came down. When they offered common fire, strange fire, holy fire came down and devoured them. Then it goes on to say, let me see, I think I need to go to page 2 where you can keep up with me. And it goes on to say at the top of page 2, dealing with this situation, it says, "Then Moses said unto Aaron," now remember, Aaron was the daddy to these boys and Moses was the uncle, "This is that the Lord spake. This is that the Lord spake, saying, I will be," what's the word? "Sanctified." That word means set apart. Those that are ministering, especially on God's altar, leading the people into the presence of the Lord. The Lord said, and those people in particular, these young men were serving in the tabernacle, "I will be sanctified. I will be set apart. I will be recognized and honored as God." And they decided that they would do it their way. So he said, "I will be sanctified in them that come nigh me. I will be sanctified in them that come nigh me. And before all the people, I will be glorified." And Aaron held his peace. Oh my God. You see, I think we're in a time in the body of Christ, we're so liberated that we have left behind and forgotten the statutes, the decreed limits of God. We have forgotten that he is a holy God and that he is a meticulous God. Now we see in the next passage here on the screen, Exodus 25 and verse 9. And here we're dealing with the fact that God is a meticulous God of order, a God that has a divine blueprint. Glory to God. And in Exodus 25 and verse 9, it says, "According to all I showed thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all the instruments thereof, even so shall you make it." Now this is God speaking to Moses. He has given Moses the spec sheet concerning the building of the tabernacle. Now we are God's tabernacle. There is a spec sheet concerning us. We can't do it our way. Glory to God. We have to follow the divine leading and the spec sheet of the Holy Ghost. Look at Exodus 25 and verse 10. "And they shall make an ark." Listen, it even brought out the wood. Shittim wood. 2 cubits and a half shall be the length thereof, and a cubit and a half the breadth thereof, and a cubit and a half the height thereof. I wanted to bring out God's spec sheet, laid out everything that was to be done. And God's spec sheet now is the word of God. God said, "Come out from among them and be ye holy, for I am holy." Yet in the body of Christ, we see those dabbling on both sides. They're in the world on Saturday night, partying, drinking, fornicating, operating in adultery, just like the unredeemed. And then they come on Sunday mornings, I'm talking about those ministering on the altar in particular, and so-called lift up holy hands, ushering in the Spirit of the Lord. You know, it makes you wonder, what are you really ushering in? Because you can usher in judgment upon yourself, even as these two boys ushered in judgment upon themselves. As I continue on down the outline, we're going to deal with Cain and Abel, a story that all of us are familiar with. And let me just set it up. You remember they both were bringing sacrifices to the Lord, to honor the Lord, to worship the Lord. And you remember the story, how Abel brought a meat offering, and we know through studying that Abel brought a lamb before the Lord to offer. And then we know that Cain brought from his garden, his harvest, or should I say, his plantains, his fruit, his vegetable, his grain offering. But you see, if our offerings do not reflect blood atonement, that offering will not be received. The Bible tells us to present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service. Our bodies, our lifestyle, we as God's temple, our whole lifestyle should reflect blood atonement, that we have been atoned by the blood of the Lamb. And when a blood atonement is in effect, it will begin to crucify the things that are attached to you, carnal things and fleshly things. But here were these two boys, and this was written, a young man, written as an example for us, to teach us that God is a meticulous God according to divine pattern. Now we're going to read right here. Well, I didn't even put those scriptures up. I thought I had it on the outline, but we remember that story, and you remember what happened. Abel's offering was received by the Lord. Again, it reflected blood atonement. Cain's offering was not received, the offering of grain and fruit and vegetable. But God let Cain know, sin lieth at the door. If you don't bring the right offering, again, present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service. If you don't bring the right offering, sin lieth at the door. And he was letting him know sin will overpower and overtake you, because sin is waiting to overpower. Sin waits for an opportunity. It waits for a legal door. And when we play with God the way some are playing with God in church, on the church pew, on the altar of the Lord, ministering to the Lord, sin lieth at the door and will find a legal right to overtake you. We see it happening all the time. I want you to see this powerful scripture right there, Malachi, on the outline, Malachi 1 and 14. This is God talking. Listen to this. This scripture most of us have forgotten about. But he says, but cursed be the deceiver. I want to say that again. But cursed be the deceiver, which hath in his flock a male and voweth. See, he vows to bring that good offering from his flock, the male offering, the best of the flock. So he makes a vow and says he'll do that. And then listen to the next part of it. And sacrifice it unto the Lord, a corrupt thing. So in other words, trade it out, making a vow saying I'm going to do this, but sacrifice a corrupt thing. That's like with your tithes and offering. You have intentions. I'm going to bring my tithes, the tenth, to the house of the Lord. But by the time you get through partying all night and drinking it up in alcohol and drugs and whatever else, then you sacrifice a corrupt thing. God watches it all. And so he said, he puts a curse on that person. Cursed is that person that brings unto the Lord a corrupt thing. And he says, for I am a great king. Do you see that in red? I want to say it again. For I am a great king, says the Lord of hosts, and my name is dreadful among the heathen. God is saying, even the heathen know I'm a great king. My name is dreadful. They tremble when they hear my name. But here you are. You are the redeemed of the Lord. You are my chosen people. You are supposed to be serving me, but yet you bring me a corrupt offering. Oh, we're talking about divine alignment today. We're talking about the plumb line that Amos saw. I believe that could be next on the outline. Not sure. Let me refer to my printed outline. And here next on the outline, oh, look at 1 Corinthians 10 and 23. Do I have it there? Yeah, you can see it. 1 Corinthians 10 and 23. And it says, all things are lawful for me. Oh, think about this. This is a powerful passage. All things are lawful for me. And that's many in the body of Christ. I'm not under the bondage of the law. No, you're not. Not the law as we know the law in the Old Testament, dealing with the Ten Commandments and so forth. But listen to the catch 20, I'm going to call it. All things are lawful to me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but all things edify not. Those things that do not edify God and give God glory, those things are not lawful in the realm of the spirit, because this is what will happen. It will cause the enemy to entrap you. That is a powerful scripture. It's so powerful that the Lord put it in the Bible twice. Let me move on down. You see, that's where is that? 1 Corinthians 10 and 23. And I need to go to page 3 of my outline. And it says, all things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. They will not help expedite the things concerning the kingdom of God. Some things will be a hindrance to the kingdom of God. In other words, where you are woman of God, but you're walking out in public in your Daisy Dukes. Oh my God, that is not expedient to the growth of the kingdom of God. It will release a hindering spirit on others that are trying to serve God. See, when we come out of the world, glory to God, when we come into the pasture of the great master, the great shepherd, there is a change. He said, all things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. He said he gives us robes of righteousness. He reclothes us in his glory. So all things, you can't participate and do everything that you see the world do. Every action needs to be examined before we tap into that. So it goes on to say right there where it isn't expedient, and it says, all things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. That is so powerful right now. Some things that we get involved in have demonic powers attached to them and will draw you away from the pasture of the master. So even though it's lawful in the sense you won't go to jail for doing this and doing that in the natural or dressing any kind of way, but it is not edifying the name of the Lord. It is not edifying the price that he paid to give us blood atonement. And it will be used, because the devil looks for legality to pull you away. When you live a carnal life and a fleshly life and you live straddle or fence, the enemy will pull you right over there into bondage. As we continue on down the outline, we're mentioning Amos and the plumb line. I'm just going to read Amos 7 and 7, the prophet of God. And it says, thus he showed me, this is Amos talking, and behold, the Lord stood upon a wall made by a plumb line with a plumb line in his hand. When God got ready to bring divine adjustment to his chosen people, Israel, he spoke to the prophet Amos and let Amos know the wall is crooked. Oh my God, what would he say about the modern day church? Should I say many in the modern day church? It's not all. What would he say? Oh my God, I already know what he's saying. And there are many that he's revealing what he's saying. We're talking about the heart of God. The Bible says, grieve not the Holy Ghost. And there are many actions that are going on in the house of the Lord that are so grieving the Holy Ghost. On this next title at the top, you see the word superfluous. And I want to deal with that word. That word is listed in the Bible several times. But I want to go to the first time that that word was mentioned. And it's in the book of Leviticus. Leviticus is the book for the priests. In the book of Leviticus, God was given instruction to those serving in the office of the priest. Do you not know in the book of Revelation, the Bible tells us that we are priests and kings because of what Jesus did. The priests would stand in the presence of the Lord, and the priests would present before the Lord offerings on behalf of the people. When we stand in the gap and we're praying for a friend that is going through or whatever, we're standing and filling in the office of the priesthood. They handled the sacrifices in the temple of the Lord. So this was given to the priest. God was speaking to Moses and letting him know who would be accepted in the priesthood and who would not. Now this was dealing with the natural, but we will apply what he gave Moses in the realm of the spirit. And it says, again, Leviticus 21 and 18, "For whatsoever man he be that hath a blemish, he shall not approach." Oh my goodness, do you see that? A blemish, he shall not approach. A blind man or a lame, or he that has a flat nose, or anything superfluous. Now, what does this mean, you're asking? In the natural, it was exactly what it was. But how does it apply in the realm of the spirit? A blemish. Maybe something that's there, you didn't forgive somebody way, way, way back. And now you're trying to serve in the office of the priesthood, serve in leadership over others. Well, the enemy will have a legal right to come and dig right into that place where that unforgiveness is and throw you all out of order. And I love the part about the flat nose. What does that mean in the realm of the spirit? It has to do with the gift of discerning of spirit. We have to know, we have to recognize, glory to God, whether it's a good spirit that's coming into the church through an individual or whether it's a bad spirit. So the Lord said if they have a flat nose. So this speaks to us today as priests in the house of the Lord. Ask God to endow us with the gifts of the spirit. Spend time in the presence of the Lord. Oh, glory to God, where you can see with his eyes, touch with his hand, speak with his mouth, feel with his feelings, glory to God. But those things, those attributes are gained by spending time with him. So the word superfluous, I have the meaning of it on there, and I'm trying to see where. Let me just, I can tell you, but I was trying to read it. Let me just read this next thing. Did I put superfluous there? But superfluous deal, it has to do with extra stuff. I may run into it. Maybe I'll put it on another page. But it has to do with extra things attached to you. In particular, as you read this in the Bible, it brought out a man with six fingers on his hand. The Lord said, that person cannot serve in my priesthood. Maybe an individual with six toes on his feet, on one of his feet, that person cannot serve. But the word superfluous, again, it has to do with extra junk. And oh my God, do we come into the house of the Lord with extra junk? I'm reminded right now of beautiful Rachel. You remember Rachel and Leah? And Rachel hid images in the camel's furniture when she was leaving her father's house. And those images, the word in the Hebrew is teraphim, which means household gods. She was going to the promised land with her husband Jacob, going to serve Jehovah God, but yet she was cleaving to teraphims, household gods, from the house of her daddy who served an idol god. We have to get cleaned out. If not, we will bring all of that filth right there into the house of the Lord, and maintain it and keep it on the inside of us. And see, it's, we all come to the Lord just as we are. But in the presence of the Lord, the anointing and the word of God is there to chop stuff off and leave it. You remember the sacrifices on the brazen altar? When they would place that sacrifice there, those priests would cut that sacrifice, and there were things taken out and burned and discarded. That is a picture, a type and shadow of what God wants to do for us. We are to be his sacrifice. Again, present your bodies as a living sacrifice. So as we look here, let me see, did I leave anything out on this outline? So we were dealing with superfluous. Now I want to read the scripture, Genesis 35 and verse 4. And it says this, and they gave unto Jacob. Oh, let me set this up. I was just mentioning those two girls. So when they were leaving, those two wives of Jacob, they were leaving their father's house. And there was a time when Jacob told them, take those earrings out your ear. Now you say, are you coming against earrings, Sister Pat? No, obviously not. I have on some. But they had on earrings that depicted idolatrous imagery, idolatrous thing. They had served idol gods all of their life. So here Jacob was taking them over to the promised land, to the God of his father, Jehovah God. And Jacob was letting them know, there are some things that will not be accepted, glory to God, by our God. You're not going to come saying you're serving Jehovah God and still cleaving to the images of old that you grew up with. So he says in Genesis 35 and verse 4, and they gave unto Jacob all the, listen to that, strange gods which were in their hand, and all their earrings which were in their ears, and Jacob hid them under the oak which was by Shechem. So Jacob had them break that stuff off, and we're going to leave it behind. Now, how does that apply to us? You got to break it off through the power of the Holy Ghost. The Bible tells us to put off lying. You got to put off lying. You have to put off being deceptive. Oh, my goodness. You have to put off operating in fornication. I've heard it before. Oh, I can't help it. Oh, my God. And just out of order sexually. Oh, my goodness. The Bible speaks of all of these things. The Lord wants us to be balanced in all areas. As he said in the word, all things are lawful, but all things edify not. If you're out of order in any way, if you're operating in a homosexual lifestyle, we already know that's not pleasing to the Lord. There are many scriptures in the Bible that deal with that. If you're operating, fornicating, as I mentioned earlier, you're married and you're having extra affairs on the side as an adulterer. These things are not accepted according to the divine specifications of God. Is he a merciful God? Yes, he is. Will he continue to work with us? Yes, he is. But there is a time, the Bible says, when the Spirit of the living God will not strive with man forever. And there are those, oh my God, that have been caught in Satan's entrapment for years, and now it has become a lifestyle. We have to be so careful. The scripture tells us to give no place to the devil. I was trying to see this last statement that I have on here. Let me read it. And it says, some items act as homing devices. Oh my goodness. I want to give you the meaning of the word homing device. Look at the top of the outline. And a homing device is the mechanism in a guided missile that guides it towards its objective. And it is, again, the mechanism in a guided missile. We can talk certain ways, and the enemy will send his guided missile right in our direction to make us his objective. You can even dress a certain way. The enemy will send a guided missile from his camp right towards you to entrap you. Oh my God. I was thinking of the priesthood, the way the Lord laid it out. And God was so meticulous and specific about the priesthood. Do you not know that that they even had a certain type of undergarment they had to put on. And the Father said in that spec sheet, if they did not have those certain undergarments on, that they would die. He said, because I don't want your nakedness up on my altar. Now, are you saying, Sister Pat, we got to go back and wear those same undergarments that the priest wore? No, but there is when the Holy Ghost will deal with you concerning even your undergarments as well as your outward garments. Things that you know came out of Fredericks of Hollywood and you're still dressing in that, that's depicting lust of the flesh, and then putting your holy garments on top of it. Now, I've never been to Fredericks of Hollywood, but I've seen some of the stuff and seen people, heard people talk about it, and in their little girly conversations, what they put on and what they do, all gendering and leading to entrapments and bondages of the devil. I know some things in particular because I did prison ministry for about 12 years, and then I have worked in deliverance for many years. And I remember one lady in particular, I talked about her in my book. I wrote her story in my book without calling out her name, of course. And it all started with an old maid. She called her an old maid. I think they call them old maids or something. But anyway, it was an aunt that she had. Maybe I shouldn't have called her an old maid. But she had an aunt, and the aunt had a hope chest, because the aunt was believing God for a husband. And the aunt had all of this lingerie in this hope chest. So when her niece, this lady that I ministered to years later, would come over, she would dress up in some of the aunt's lingerie. And as a result of that, a spirit got a hold of her. And at a very young age, she began leaving out of her bedroom window in the wee mornings of the hour to go and sleep with quite a few lovers, boy lovers. And then it went on over into her marriage. When her husband would go to work, she would slip to another state that's nearby to go and sleep with some of those lovers from her past. We're talking about how the devil will entrap you. He has been on the battlefield a long time. Oh, I could tell you some deliverance stories, but this is the main thing I want to tell you as we started off with. When we get the mind of not saying what's wrong with it, there's nothing wrong with it, versus with him, I want nothing wrong, then God can continue to mold and make, develop us, take us from glory to glory and victory to victory. As we continue on the outline, we're at the end of it, and I've already referenced entrapments of the devil. Oh, I could share some testimony, but anyway, the next statement says, oh, this is concerning a deliverance minister in her book. I won't call her name, but she was operating, praying deliverance over a young girl that had gotten trapped in satanic worship. And this young girl had on all the black lipstick and the hair dyed exceedingly black, and all black clothing and black fingernail polish. And this minister says she came down off of that platform and she asked, anybody have any fingernail polish remover in the audience? And she began to remove even the fingernail polish, getting rid of the devil's homing device. Oh, if you haven't studied the books of deliverance ministers, I tell you that will help your journey a lot, because you will begin to be informed of how the devil entraps us. And it's mostly because we're living with that mindset. There's nothing wrong with that. Oh my goodness. I look at the new set of praise and worship leaders on the altar, and all you can see is thighs and almost exposed behinds because of all the tears and cuts on the jeans. Oh my God, our God is a God with the spirit of excellence. Now, are you saying, Sister Pat, we got to be in a robe? No, but we should dress with the spirit of excellence where we edify him. It's God handing out torn, raggedy, messed up clothing from the kingdom. No, he brought us in from a ragged, torn, messed up lifestyle to reclothe us in his glory. You know, many things in the natural point to the spirit, and some things just a matter of just asking him, God, what does this say that I have on? What message is it giving out? And that would solve a whole lot of problems in the body of Christ. And then this very last scripture on my outline, Matthew 5 and 48. Be ye therefore, what does it say? Perfect. There it is again. This is the book of Matthew. Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. The meaning of the word perfect, again, full grown adult. A full age, mature. God wants us to walk in maturity. This is something else we have to remember. We as the vessels of God, we as has been said for many years, are sometimes the only Bible that others will see. When they look at you, what are they reading from your Bible? Think about it. Oh my God. Again, a plumb line message. Even as the vehicles in the natural that we drive, automobiles give messages to let us know something is wrong with the vehicle, the Word of God and the servants of God are used by the Holy Ghost to release messages. It's time to check ourselves. Jesus is coming soon. Oh, Father God, I thank you, Lord, for the Holy Ghost. I thank you that he dwells inside of us. I thank you that he is the comforter and he's also the corrector. Oh, and it's the Holy Ghost that's working on us. He's working on us to perfect us so that on that day we can stand before you, Father God. The Bible says a church without spot and wrinkle. That's why you laid out a pattern in the Old Testament about a priest carrying blemishes, carrying superfluous thing. Oh my God, many bound up on drugs that are addictive and yet up trying to lead others. Oh my God. Oh, but we can get before him and get delivered ourselves. Father, I thank you for the teaching of this word. We just release the anointing of the Holy Ghost upon each viewer, upon each listener. And I thank you, Holy Ghost, that you will continue to develop this word in each one. And you will continue to perfect us, mold and make us, so that on that day we can hear, well done, good and faithful servant, and not depart from me. I never knew you. Oh my God. This is Minister Pat Holmes signing off. Just want to decree again the blessings of the Lord upon you and say shalom, which means peace. Until next time.